Hello there and welcome to News Desk on CCTV News. I'm Li Dongying in Beijing. We start with China's political season here in Beijing. A news conference is being held by the country's housing authority, and the briefing is about rebuilding shanty areas and real estate development. The minister and vice ministers of housing and urban rural development will meet the press and take questions. And now let's go live to the conference hall to see what's going on there.
好，谢谢，请回到各自的位置。各位记者朋友。
Dear media friends, good morning. Welcome to the fourth session of the 12th NPC. For today's press conference, it is the last meeting here in Media Center. And for today, we will talk about the jobs regarding rundown area reconstruction and real estate. Today, we are so glad to invite Minister Chen Zhenggao and Vice Minister Lu Kehua and Vice Minister Ni Hong from Ministry of Housing and Urban Rural Development. Now let's welcome Mr. Chen to give a brief introduction. Dear media friends, it's my great pleasure to share the thoughts and discuss with you regarding the rundown area reconstruction and real estate. For this regard, it's really related, closely related to people's well-being, urbanization, and economic development. For the CPC Central Committee, attached a great importance to this regard, and we have already achieved a very great progress in 12th five-year plan. And in this year's working reports, Premier Li Keqiang also gave the direction and the new target for these areas. We will implement into more details. And now me and two ministers will welcome your questions. Thank you very much. Now the floor is open.
谢谢，我是经济日报和中国经济网的记者。我的问题是，去年下半年以来，房地产市场出现了回升的态势，但是市场的分化在加剧。我们注意到，一线城市的房地产市场价格有了明显的上涨，但是三四线城市的库存量依然很大。那么，住建部如何看待今年的房地产市场形势？同时，有人认为，一线城市的房地产市场价格，在快速上涨之后，还会出现一定的回落。那么，在您看来，楼市是否会出现大起大落？谢谢。
With economic daily, since the second half of last year, the real estate market has been regaining momentum, but the divergence in the housing markets is exacerbating. The housing prices in first-tier cities have been soaring, however, those in the third and fourth-tier cities remain low. What is your assessment of the real estate market this year? Some people also say that the housing prices in first-tier cities may come down after the surge. Will there be some dramatic swings in the market this year?
对现在的房地产形势,
for the current momentum of real estate, especially for the next steps, actually that's the big concern or the focus among the society. My understanding, or I believe, if we talk about the future momentum, we should look at the main characters and also the background. For the current real estate market, we have three key features. Number one, sales is rebounding. For 2014, our sales revenue and the sales area both decreased by 7% and 6.3% respectively. Last year, the sales started to come back month by month, and the sales area increased by 6.5%, and sales revenue increased by 14%. For this year, January and February, we keep this momentum, so our judgment is sales now is rebounding. And for the second feature, we have a quite big divergence. and these become worse and worse. For the first tier, compared to tier 3 and tier 4, that's very much different, which also give us a big challenge in regulation. That's also our big target or job to do. And for the third is we have a big excess inventory. By the end of last year, we have 718 million square of inventory, and this number increased to 719 by 15% increase. Of course, inventory basically exists in tier 3, tier 4 cities, the three features right now in the market. And now we would like to talk about the four, our forecast for the future. We should look at the basic conditions we have. For the first one, China economy, the big momentum not changed. Last year, our economy increased by 6.9%, and for this year, the number is projected to be 6.5 to 7%. By 2020, we will enter to the prosperous society in all respects. This is the basic conditions. Based on these, we have the solid foundation for realistic market development. And second, we talk about there is nothing change on urbanization. Right now, we have 717 million people living in urban areas, and the urbanization is 56.5%. By the end of 13th 5-year plan, we should achieve the number to a higher level. So this is also provide a large potential to the real estate market. And third, we talk about the people's demand, especially for the new residents. Their demand not change. So they have the firm requirement, and also for the improvement demand. And also the demand quantity is quite large. For the urban residents and for the new residents, all these requirements are also the big potential for the future development. And number four, we also have the great support from the Central Committee. We have all the necessary macro measures, and for each cities and towns, they all have the responsibility in this regard. Overall, for the healthy and the steady development is confirmed. We should have the confidence in this.
With Beijing Youth Daily, the Central Economic Work Conference made clear that housing system reform must be deepened to meet new demands for housing. What is the approach to deepening such reform? Is it possible that government-subsidized housing will be abolished in the future? And do you have any future plans and specific measures for that?
For the housing policies, that's a quite important part to the national, that's related to the country's development and also important to people's well-being, being as well as the country's key policies. We need to have a clear direction to fulfill the new demand. And we also need to focus on the both renting and the purchasing systems. So based on this, the Ministry of Housing and Rural Urban Areas, we focus on these areas and we drafted the related regulations and the rules. We're now all under progress. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. 预计2015到2017年共开工1800万套。 今年李克强总理在政府工作报告中也指出，实施棚户区改造计划要新开工600万套。那么请问陈部长，截至目前为止，棚户区改造情况实施进展如何？还有什么困难和对策？谢谢。
Last year, the State Council put forth the three-year plan of renovating the rundown areas with the target of starting construction on 18 million housing units between 2015 and 2017. According to this year's work report of the government, delivered by Premier Li, 6 million housing units will be rebuilt in rundown urban areas. Can you give us the latest updates on the progress that has been made so far? What are the difficulties and how are you going to address them?
For your question, I'll invite Mr. Li Hong to answer. For rundown area reconstruction, that's a big project that involves 100 million residents moving to the new house. And this is also a developing projects that increase the efficiency of urban planning development and also stimulate the consumption. For this project, it's received a great importance from the national central government, and we have the related documents to guide us the work, especially in the renovation of rundown areas. For the rundown areas, we have the clear rules and regulations, and as well as the guidance. Starting from last year, the CBC committee also gave us a three-year plan, which involves 18 million housing units. Last year, our target is 5.8 million units, and we have finished 6 million. The efforts is the greatest, and also it involved the largest scope. And we also, in the first year of 13th 5 year period, and for this year we also need to finish rebuilding of 5 million units, and we also need to strengthen the monetary housing compensation, which means we have an even harder job need to be finished in 13th 5 year plan. And all these challenged or difficult issues will come up for sure. On the other side, for the fiscal revenue, growth rate will slow down. So we have also the difficulties in capitalization or the financing. So that's also bring us another round of challenges. But we have fully confidence to hit the target by 3 points. Number one, we have great support from the central government. From the fiscal revenue and also the other areas, although the pressure or the challenge is quite big, but we still receive a great support in the rundown area reconstruction. And second, we have the general planning and working plan in this regard. And third, we also receive the help from the national banks. So we have all the support to give us a strong impetus in this regard. Thank you very much.
谢谢主持人，我是江苏新闻广播的记者，我的问题还是继续追问房价，因为最近呢，就是一些城市的房价涨得很厉害，像北京、上海、深圳，有些媒体报道说一夜之间涨了几十万，但是在二线城市，我来自江苏南京，南京虽然是二线城市，但是房价已经直逼一线了，今年一月份南京有一块商品房的地价已经拍出了42.2亿平米，所以老百姓都感觉这房价涨疯了，所以想问问程部长。
就是您怎么看眼下这个房价疯涨的原因，有没有办法促进他们理性回归？谢谢。房价问题啊。With
Jiangsu Broadcasting, recently we have seen a strong surge in the housing prices in some big cities. There are even reports that in Beijing, Shanghai, and Shenzhen, the housing prices surged by several hundred thousand RMB overnight. But in some second-tier cities such as Nanjing, where I come from, housing prices are also rising, and people are pretty worried about the frenzy in the housing prices and the housing markets. What is your comment on that? What do you think are the reasons that caused such frenzy in the housing market? Do you think will you have any measures to tackle that?
As for housing price, all society give a close attention to this because that's related to all people's interests as well as the healthy development of real estate market as well as the macroeconomic development. As I said before, we have a quite severe polarization that also reflect from the pricing areas. For tier 3, tier 4 cities, the price right now is coming down. So the big situation or the challenging situations right now basically in the tier 1 cities and the part of the tier 2 cities. For the big job right now for us, we need to stable the price in tier 1 cities and part of the tier 2 cities. As we all know, after the Chinese New Year, there is a big surge or big change. We all have witnessed this abnormal surge. And all the related governments and departments already taken measures in this regard. Number one, we have the strict regulations and the implementations on the house buying quota. And the second, we also need to make the transparent policies. And the third, we also need to increase the numbers we supply in small and medium size of housing. Number four, we also need to punish seriously to the law breaking and rule breaking behaviors. And all the related ministers and departments all have clear directions and positions. Based on all these works, we already have achieved certain results. For part of the tier 2 cities, their price also increased so fast, and we give a close attention and we communicate timely. Right now for the tier 2 cities, we all have the certain measures to stabilize the housing price. Besides the tier 2 and tier 1 cities, we also need to have the good regulation and also the control on price and give the timely measures in order to make sure the steady and healthy development in real estate markets.
陈部长您好，我是来自中国网的记者。我这个问题还是跟房价有关，因为房价是大家都非常关心的问题。现在社会上有一种担忧，认为目前我国的房地产市场似乎和80年代的日本非常的相似。我们看到当时日本的房价从85年开始，在六年内是增长了3倍，随后从91年开始出现了断崖式下跌。那么现在这种担忧就认为，中国的楼市可能也会像当时的日本一样发生崩盘，请问对此您怎么看？谢谢。
With China.org.cn, my question is also about the housing market. Some people believe that China's real estate market is similar to that of Japan in the 1980s. In a short span of 6 years since 1985, the housing prices in Japan tripled.But after 1991, the housing prices nosedived in Japan's housing markets. What is your comment on that?
The question you raised, there are some internet coverage and also the discussion among the society. I also actually communicated with some experts in this regard. I would like to address first, time is different.The thing happened in Japan, that's 20 or 30 years ago. The politics, economics, it's all different, it's totally different, we can put it this way. And second, we have a different national condition. Urbanization in China and Japan is different. We're also in the different economic development stage, and we also have different macro regulations. So I would say we cannot compare these two countries together. Thank you.
With Xinhua News Agency, we have seen that recently many localities have unveiled policies to encourage migrant workers to buy homes in cities. But many still argue that migrant workers with their limited financial means cannot afford housing in cities, and sometimes they will be forced to go back to their hometown if they cannot find jobs in the cities. What is the central authority's view about these policies? Will they introduce measures for migrant workers to buy homes in the cities in the future?
我感觉呀, 我们应该带着感情来讨论这个问题。
I feel that we should put in a more emotional way, because for migrant workers, they contribute a large part to all our lives, so we need to give more care to them. And also for our parents or grandparents, we're back to that generation, we're all migrant workers. So from my understanding is first, in the working conference, we said we need to fulfill the new demand from the new residents. We not just fulfill their purchasing demand, as well as we also need to think about their renting requirements. So this is already in the conference we stated, and we need to implement it for sure. Second, we need to think about the people-centered urbanization. So the migrants coming to the city to buy house, that's also helped to develop the urbanization. And third, for migrant workers, it helps them to find jobs or even they started their own business. So this is also bring a better life to their works. So for the migrant workers, they have the house, they have a wife, and then they have children, they have a happy life in cities. I also invited some migrant workers. They have a very happy life. So if they can purchase a house or rent a house, then that give improve their life standing. And the house purchased by migrant workers took up 30% in rural areas. So I see migrant workers purchase house in cities have a big potential. So right now for a different city, they have a different guidance in this regard. First, we need to give them the basic beneficial policies, especially for their children. We need to guarantee their children have school to go to. I know it's quite a challenge, but for each local government, they are working in this regard. And the second, we also issued some beneficial policies to get migrant workers to purchase houses. And number three, we need to do all our efforts to solve the problems of migrants' jobs issues. So we need to give them jobs or they can find jobs so they can support them to stay in the cities. And all the departments and the governments work together to encourage migrant workers. Especially right now we have the agriculture banks. They are working in this regard. So for the first month, they gave 17 billion financial support to help the migrant workers to purchase house. But it is a historic progress. It should be realized step by step. Thank you.
Thank you, 主持人. 部长您好.
我是中央电视台央视网央视新闻客户端的记者。你好，刚才您接了很多的应招哈，回应了很多关于房地产价格的问题。确实大家现在都非常的关心我们能不能买得起房，但是当然大家也更关心我们什么时候才能买得上房，因为这可能跟我们的住房保障有关。所以我想问一个关于住房公积金的问题。我们注意到住房公积金管理条例的修订，这个修订草案应该说是从征求意见以来就一直都没有出台，我们很想知道它什么时候才会公布。而在整个的公开征求意见过程当中，讨论的最多的关键点是什么？而且刚才您也是带着感情说到了农民工的问题，因为这里面也涉及到他们。比如说很多城市已经推出了计划，把这个在城镇里面有稳定就业的农业转移人口纳入到这样一个住房公积金的体系当中，而且住建部也说了，农民工、个体工商户都会在这个体系里面。那这是不是就是为了去三四线城市房地产的库存呢？那如果说将来这个三四线城市的库存都去了，那这些群体，这些我们怀着感情的农民工朋友们，那他们还会继续留在这样的一个体系当中吗？谢谢。
I'm with CCTV. You just now answered some tough questions about the soaring housing prices in some of China's cities. Of course, people would be worried about whether we can afford homes in the cities, but more importantly, we are worried about whether housings will be made more available and more accessible in the future. So that brings us to the question of the Provident Fund. We note that the regulations on the management of Provident Funds are still being amended. So my question is, when will the amended regulations be issued to the public? And can you also share with us what are the hottest topics that are being debated during the amendment process? You also mentioned the group of migrant workers buying homes in cities. Is it possible to include those migrant workers in the Provident Fund system? And is this a step aimed at reducing inventory in the third tier and fourth tier housing markets? And if those inventory is finally reduced, do you think the migrant workers will still stay within the system?
For your question, I will invite Mr. Ke Hua to answer. It's my great pleasure to answer your sharp question. As we all know, for the Provident Fund policies, we started from 1994. Till 1999, we released the regulation. Till now, we have 217 million people involved in this system, and we received 8.95 trillion capitals in this regard. And have 4.88 trillion is withdrawn. And we have 100 million people through this system solve their housing purchasing issues. This is a new policy, of course, so and during the implementation, there are issues and problems. In order to improve this regulation, in the third plenary session of 18th NPC meeting, we need to have an open, transparent regulation. So we need to improve the system of utilization, withdrawal, and management. So we have a wide scope of survey, and we have amended the regulation, as you mentioned. The related works, amendment works, already finished last September and last November and December. National Policy Office is open to the public for suggestions to these amended regulations. And we received 856 suggestions.
我们归纳一下大概的五六个方面。
So that involves
第一个
suggestion to five or six areas. Number one, to talk about the proportion of
怎么样限高
submitting visual
体现缴存的公平。
How we can reflect is this a fair policy? And second, we talk about scope of people, which group of people is suitable to include in this regulation. As you mentioned, for certain groups, they should be considered into the regulation or not, especially the affordable capabilities, like you mentioned the migrant workers. That's all been raised in the suggestions. And also we received suggestions regarding that it's quite difficult to get a loan or to use the fund. And number four, we also received talk about the housing value increasing or the fund increasing because this is their own money, its own capital. They also want to know for the money, how to make sure that the value keep increasing. And the number five, they also talk about the regulations and management of funds.
那么呢，这个相关的这个修改啊、上报等等这些方面的工作啊，正在进行过程当中。
For all the related works is under progress. So this is your first question.
所以呢，你的第二问呢是。
For your second question, you ask
农民工
about the migrant workers.Individuals will be included in the amended regulation. The regulation is not released yet, so you cannot see they're already included or not. To answer your question,After they included in the system, they buy a house and then they quit. I cannot give you a clear answer to this. Thank you.
请中区这个倒数第二排右侧对第三位记者。
谢谢主持人。陈部长好，我是中国日报的记者。我们注意到去年的棚户区改造中呢，特别强调货币化安置的方式，就是刚才倪副部长也提到了。那我们想请问，其中的考量是什么？主要的目的是不是为了去库存？谢谢您。
With China Daily, we noticed that last year it was emphasized that people displaced by the rebuilding of rundown urban areas should receive monetary housing compensation rather than housing.What are the considerations behind that? Is it aimed at reducing inventory in the property markets?
For your question, also invite Mr. Ni Hong to answer. We talk about rundown area. What is the benefits if we conducted a monetary compensation? I give you five reasons. Number one, we increase efficiency. For moving back housings, they need 2 or 3 years. But we give them monetary compensation for the people that's involved in this regard. They have the capital to move into new house, so they do not need to wait for that long time. That's why we say we increase efficiency. Second, we give more choices. This solution that's very welcomed by all the people involved. So they have more choices to choose a house where they want to move, either near a school or the place they prefer. They also can choose they want to buy a new house or resold house. So for the overall renovation of rundown areas, it's not limited by seasons, especially for winters.In the northeast, for the old industrial areas, we all know is northwest region was extremely cold, but we also can conduct the renovation in the freezing winter, so that's a good thing. And number four, last year, we have a 29.9% of monetary compensation, and this year, as Minister Chen required,We need to increase the number to 50%.
可以说呢，这个对于消化大量的库存是一。
For reduce inventory, has also bring a good news to this regard.
可以更加的。
And number five, that is more open, transparent process. Thank you.
请左区第三排那位对举手的记者。
谢谢主持人，我是光明日报光明融媒体记者。今天是315消费者权益保护日，我的问题和保障这个购房者权益有关。那么最近我们了解到呢，一些房地产中介通过发布虚假房源信息、加价卖房、谋取暴利等不法手段坑害消费者。那么请问住建部如何加强这方面的监管，维护购房者的合法权益？谢谢。
I'm with Guangming Daily. Today is the day of the protection of consumers' rights and interests. So my question is about the protection of the rights and interests of the consumers in the housing market. There have been reports that some property intermediaries ripped off the consumers by posting problematic housing information, driving up housing prices, and other illegal means. How will the Ministry of Housing and Urban Rural Development strengthen regulation in the market so as to ensure that the rights and interests of the consumers can be ensured?
For
your question, I invite Mr. Ke Hua to answer. For the property brokerage company, they provide intermediary services, which is also part of the real estate market. Right now, we have 60,000 brokerage companies in China. All of these companies play a great role to stimulate the housing market. However, there is illegal means in certain companies. They break laws and the rules, and through the illegal means to generate profits and hurt consumers' rights and interests. Therefore, our ministry from this year will have a specific rectification in this regard. Overall, we'll consider in the following aspects. Number one, we'll rectify the housing release information. As you mentioned, they release some fake information or the information they made up, and they hidden the real situation of the house, or the house is not available, but they post on their board so to cheat consumers. So we ask them to provide full, completed, timely, and correct information on housing. That's number one. Second, we will fully implement the ownership transfer. By doing this, we will forbid the one house selling to two owners happens. And number three, we will have strict management and control on the housing sales, so the companies will not take up and cheat consumers, so they cannot take up all the capitals they earned in the illegal means. And number four, we will also increase the control and the management on brokerage companies. So we will have their all the documents on hand, all their records, so they have the quality and they can do the property checking, the housing selling, and all other process. So they need to get the qualification. Number five, we will have strict control on the brokerage company's practitioners. So right now, the people involved in this regard, their skill set is very low. We need to give them trainings and educations.
中介从业人员恪守职业道德。
They need to follow and to be more professional. They should follow the rules and regulations.
违背从业人员职业道德。
If the person or the people in this regard break the laws or the rules, I say they guide in purpose or assist.
提供书这个伪造的一些书面的一些材料
in purpose to give the fake documents and run from the regulations and generate illegal profits. So we will have a strong punishment in this regard. Six,
就是要完善
信用体系系统 further improve
The
credit system. We will build up
the
credit record system of property brokerage companies. For the rule breaking or law breaking companies, they will in the system. So basically, they were in the blacklist. So they do not have the credit. It's not worth to trust.
We
also gave the warning to consumers to be careful to choose the brokerage companies. And number seven, for all the authorities in each level will strengthen our day-to-day management. So we have...DA on the spot checking or DA check on a regular basis where we receive the complaints from consumers, all different ways to control the companies. So we will have a talk with the companies or we disclose information on the media. For all of these measures,We not just only punish the violation and the illegal companies, we also want to increase the service quality in the housing market. For certain broad companies, they help what they are doing.The capitalization outside. For PBOC and the related regulations, we have a clear position. We will help the ministries and the departments to do our jobs. Through all the efforts in all the ministries and departments, as well as the self-regulation of brokerage companies and practitioners, as well as media.Management and control, as well as by the society, will have a regulated housing market in the future. Thank you very much.
左川的第一位记者。
你好，我是中国国际广播电台的记者。我想问一个关于这个开放式小区建设的一个问题。我知道这个话题，前一段时间应该是在舆论场上引起了比较这个高的一些关注和一些争议吧。在两会期间呢，我也注意到，像北京市已经公布了一些区域，可能是在三里河那边可能有一些方案。那么在长沙县呢，可能已经开始在它的这个县政府的大院已经打开了，变成那种公共的绿地公园。我想问一下，这个是不是代表着这些相关的措施已经在推进过程中了？另外，老百姓可能比较关注的就是说，如果是涉及到小区或者是一些业主权益的问题。可能是不是和现行的一些法律有一些相背离的一些地方？作为住建部这个主管部门来讲，将如何协调或者是回应这个社会的关切？谢谢。
I'm with CRI. My question is about opening up the gated communities, and this issue has triggered a lot of debates in the society and drawn a lot of attention. We know that some localities, for example, Beijing, has already made some announcements of certain plans that will be applied to certain parts of the city. And also in Changsha, they have already opened up the compound, the gated compound of the local government. Does this mean that relevant measures are now being implemented?
In addition, people who will be affected by this initiative are worried that whether such an initiative will violate the relevant rights and interests of those homeowners that might be affected and in contravention of the existing laws and regulations. So how will the ministry respond to that?
First,
thank you all the people and the society give great attention to our job. We all know after 37 years we had the World Conference on Urban Development. President Xi Jinping and Premier Li Keqiang had a great speeches, and we also released the suggestions on further implement the urban planning and management. These give a great guideline, directions and key jobs in the future urban planning management. So during the study and discussion, we also received the questions online. So our ministry also gave a clear answer in this regard. Right now, for our current key job, we need to first understand, implement the suggestions from the Central Committee, and we also, during the implementation, we should fully protect people's rights and interests. Thank you very much.
我来自民主党派的媒体团结报团结网，也是结合315问一个关于房屋质量的问题。我们知道房屋建筑质量关系着直接关系着每个人的生命健康财产安全，大家都很关注，也是维权的一个热帖。但近年来我们知道楼倒倒楼脆脆类似这样的事件时有发生，大家也都很痛心。据统计2015年全国共发生房屋市政工程安全生产事故442起，死亡554人。有观点认为，在建筑过程中的违法转包、层层分包，不仅严重影响房屋质量，且多少年后导致开发商、建筑商可能已人去楼空，难以追责。对此您怎么看？您认为事故频发的原因是什么？住建部将采取哪些措施遏制事故发生，保障房产安全？谢谢。
I'm with Unity News. My question is about the quality of the buildings in China, since that today is the day of protecting consumers' rights and interests. It's only fitting that I ask this question because the quality of buildings matters to the safety of property and life of every one of us. In recent years, we have seen a lot of cases of building collapsing across the nation. According to relevant statistics, in 2015, we have seen 442 workplace accidents costing the lives of 554 people. Some people believe that the subcontracting in the construction or real estate market will not only affect the quality of the buildings, but also make it very difficult to hold the developers or the constructors accountable for what would happen in the future. How will the ministry see this issue? What are the reasons, do you think, behind the collapsing of these buildings, and what measures will be taken to address them?
For your question, I think I have the same feeling as you. And as the Ministry of Housing, we did not really did a good job in this regard. That's our responsibility. For the quality of the housing, that's a big issue. This related to people's safety and property, and also related to the stabilized society development. And also we need to think about the resource utilization in this regard. So this also draw a great attention among the society. Due to different reasons and backgrounds, the accidents happened, still happened. So we have a two-year rectification, the two-year plan in this regard. It started 2 years ago, that's 2014 October, so we have clear ownership, and we also have the a strict punishment to the related developers and constructors. Right now, we say we achieve the result, but we still have a long way to go. For the original, especially the shanty or the old house, from last June, we started the checking and also the rectification around China. Right now, the work is still under progress, but I would like to say it's really a tough job. That's all. Thank you.
请这个中区第三排这个右侧第二位记者。
谢谢主持人，我是法制晚报的记者。刚才陈部长您回答的很多问题都是和购房有关，我想问您一个和租房有关的问题。那么在去年底的这个中央经济工作会议上就提出了要建立这个购租并举的这个住房制度。那么在现实生活当中，购房的市场相对来说是很成熟的，那么租房市场呢，它相对来说发展之后，并且在这个监管当中也存在很多问题。我想请问陈部长，您觉得造成现在这个租房的这个市场相对混乱的一个局面，它的原因是什么？那么住建部有什么样的具体措施来解决这些问题？谢谢。
I'm with the Mirror. My question is about renting homes. The Central Economic Work Conference called for the establishment of a housing system that encourages both renting and purchasing. Yet, in reality, China's home rental market remains underdeveloped compared with the development of the purchasing home buying market.And the regulation is also lacking in the renting market. So what do you think is the reason for that? What will be the next steps taken by the ministry?
For your question, I invite Mr. Ni Hong to answer. For renting house issues, at first look at, we have three policies. Number one, we talk about buy and the sell market.And also we look at the rental market. And number three, we talk about the housing guarantee markets. The housing markets developed and improved. So the overall system is under building, especially in the recent years. We build up a lot of government subsidized buildings.Of course, for the renting market compared to the other areas, it's still quite far beyond the development. Right now, we not have a specific companies in this regard, especially dealing with renting, and also not establish the scope of business. And right now, we also talk about the second-hand, resold, and old houses.We not have a quite new houses in the rental market, renting market. And as we said, there are a lot of illegal or violation happened in the brokerage companies. And number four, for our regulations, policies and related laws also need to be further improved. Right now, we are studying the rules and regulations in renting houses. So involved number one, we focus on the establishment of regulations and laws as well as systems and mechanisms. We need to regulate the behavior of renting. And we also need to have strict supervision and give the direction and clear laws to the related companies and individuals. And we want to have a completed and a healthy, smoothly developed renting market. Thank you very much.
谢谢主持人。陈部长你好，我是《华尔街日报》的记者。我想问的问题是，针对这个农民的入城买房的这个问题，首付的问题。现在开发商因为为了鼓励农民入城买房，他们降低了首付。提供了首付的贷款，配置也越来越多。你觉得这个会增加楼市的风险吗？谢谢。
My question is about the migrant workers buying homes in the cities, in particular the down payment that will be paid by the migrant workers. Some of the developers, in seeking their own interests, have relaxed the conditions for the migrant workers to make down payments to buy homes. Some of them even provide loans for down payments to be made by the migrant workers. Do you think that will add to the risks to the to the housing market?
For migrant workers buying a house in cities, the down payment proportion is the same as other people's. Of course, for the tier cities, first tier cities, a little bit different. We talk about the outside markets, financial support to migrant workers or other people's. We have a very clear attitude from the PBOC. This is not allowed. So we need to have a specific program to rectify this part. So the ministry will help the related parties to do the supervision and management. Thank you very much.
谢谢主持人，我是中华建筑报的记者，想问一下陈部长啊，就是您从您刚才介绍这些情况来看呢，这个房地产市场可以说已经这个呈现了企稳的态势。那么鉴于房地产对宏观经济的这个重要作用，这个是否表明经济下行压力的一个主要方面正在这个化解？谢谢。
And with China Construction News, according to what you said about the current state and the recent trends of the real estate market, it seems that the market is now stabilizing. Given the significance of the property market to the macro economy, does it mean that a main factor for downward pressure on the economy is being resolved?
For real estate, it's closely related to people's well-being, the economic and social development, and also can have a big impact to all the respects. For right now, we already improved a big number in the people's living areas. And also people's assets or their properties mainly reflect from the housings they own. We talk about the urbanization. The real estate market also gave a great support in this regard. Right now, we have 770 million people at the permanent residence in cities. We talk about 1978. It's just 170 million people back to that time. We can see a large number of people from rural area to urban area, which means there also there were a big requirements on housing. We also talk about last year, the value that contributed in the housing market is 6.1%. And the investments normally is 20%. Last year is a little bit different, it's just 17%. So that's really closely to the economic development. For the housing markets, that's really related to urbanization, the social and economic development, as well as people's well-being. We need to follow the national national committee's requirements to make sure steady and healthy development in the housing market.
谢谢主持人。部长您好，我是香港中评社中评网的记者。那我的问题是，香港现在有很多开放式小区，那小区内的道路开放也取决于政府的规划。然后这种情况下，小区也基本可以确保安全。那想请问，香港街区制对于内地的开放小区有何启示呢？然后如何借鉴这种比较成熟的街区制经验，确保居民的安全？谢谢。
I'm with China.Review News. You may know that there are a lot of open rather than gated communities in Hong Kong and whether the roads within these open communities will be connected to the public road system depends on the planning of the local government and basically the safety of those roads and those people in the communities can be ensured. Do you think that the successful and mature experience of open communities in Hong Kong can serve as an inspiration for similar initiatives on the mainland?
For the road or block system, we just give a big direction. For more detailed implementation, we will also give out a more detailed plans and also the regulations. So that's also need time. It's a process. It cannot be made or complete in one night. Thank you.
香港文汇报文汇网记者，我有一个问题想请问陈部长。香港房价最近一直在跌，而一河之隔的深圳房价却一直在涨。深圳本轮房价暴涨之前，其实它的价格是远低于京沪的。但是一年之后，北京、上海的房价在深圳面前都成了小矮子。有机构估测，深圳的房价负担可能不仅仅是内地第一，而是已经超越香港，成为世界第一了。请问您怎么看？谢谢您。
I'm with Wen Huipo from Hong Kong. You may know that the housing prices in Hong Kong have been falling. However, Shenzhen has seen its housing prices soaring over last year. Actually, before last year's surge, the housing prices in Shenzhen fell far behind those in Beijing and Shanghai. And some people argue that the housing prices now in Beijing and Shanghai have been dwarfed by those in Shenzhen, and Shenzhen has not only become the most expensive housing market on the mainland, but also in the world, overtaking Hong Kong. What is your response to that?
I already answered your question. So after Chinese New Year, for the four cities of Tier 1, the surge is really rapid. So with the efforts of the related governments as well as the central government, for all those four cities already taken the measures and improved the situation. We fully believe they have the conditions and capabilities to stabilize the housing market.
最后一个问题，给一二三第五排的那个第五排那个白记者。
谢谢主持人，我是来自深圳卫视的记者。我们都知道创新和发展是今年两会的一个关键词，那么其实深圳在这个一直都在坚持这个质量驱动创新发展和这个绿色低碳发展。那么目前呢，深圳就是已经是在全国率先以及全面的实施绿色建筑的这样一个标准。目前的绿色建筑的面积已经是超过了2100万平方米，这个规模可以说是居于全国的首位了。那么我想请问陈部长，您对此是怎么看的？另外，国家是提出一个目标啊，是到2020年，全国的这个绿色建筑的一个比例推广要达到50%。那么您对这样的一个目标是否有信心？目前的这个推广的进度如何呢？谢谢。
好。
And with Shenzhen TV, we know that our nation has been promoting innovation-driven development and green low-carbon development in recent years, and Shenzhen has really been the pioneer, especially in adopting the green building standards. Actually, the area covered by green buildings has reached 21 million square meters, topping the ranks of all cities in China. What is your comment on that? And we know that by 2020, we need to ensure that 50% of the cities in China will have green buildings. Do you think that goal can be reached? And can you share with us some of the latest update on that?
The question you mentioned, I'll put in this way. For the grading building or the green construction materials, we also attach a great importance. As we all know, green development, that's a key element in our 13th five-year plan. So all the housing constructions should follow the green policy. Let me divide it into two parts. Number one is during the construction stage, and second is during the utilization stage. So that involves the construction materials. We need to use green materials, as you mentioned, the situation in Shenzhen, that's a good example. And we also talk about that right now we fully push forward that the productions or the modules they produce in the factories, and they also assembled in the factory, so that save the cost, save the energy, and also increase the efficiency. And we also talk about the housing utilization. We also need to fully facilitate the green development. If we can achieve the both green development in all these both aspects, we can achieve the green house. Thank you very much.
And that was the press conference given by the Minister Chen Zhenggao and two other Vice Ministers of Housing and Urban Rural Development. This is actually the last press conference held by the ministers, the CPPCC members and the MPC deputies during the two sessions. And when answering the questions from media, the Minister and Vice Ministers said that the problem of over housing inventory is very serious in China, but given the steady process of urbanization and people's demand for housing and a steady economic growth, the minister, Chen Zhenggao, is very confident that China's real estate market will develop in a very healthy manner. And many questions actually focused on housing price. And Minister Chen Zhenggao responded by saying that measures have been taken to adjust and control housing prices, including house purchase restriction, increasing land supply, and increasing the number of medium and small-sized units, etc. The ministry will try its best to maintain a steady housing price in first-tier and second-tier cities in the country. And another focus is to rebuild the shanty areas. The Vice Minister Niu Hong said this year's target of building 6 million units in shanty areas will be completed. And other focuses also include the policies to encourage migrant workers to buy homes in the cities and regulating the real estate agents, etc. The CCTV News will give you a full review of the press conference, more insights of the press conference given by the Ministry of Housing and Urban Rural Development.